it's an e-commerce platform based in London. And because I work in e-commerce, I really care about the conversion on our user base. Conversion is basically the fraction of users that go through the entire booking flow and arrive in the confirmation page based on the total amount of users that land in the homepage. A lot of companies like Google, Alibaba, doing some analysis, discovered that mobile web has a lot of problems. For instance, mobile web can convert 1/4 on a desktop web experience. And if you compare the same mobile website with the native version, can convert like half. This is because the process is very manual. The user has to fill in billing information, email, name. It has to remember the credit card number, the expiration date, a lot of information. It has to fill in multiple forms across multiple pages, maybe dealing with fat fingers and multiple keyboards. So some years ago, Chrome has introduced autofill that help out decreasing the friction a bit, but still doesn't resolve a lot of problems on the user experience and on the developer experience. So today, we introduced Payment Request API that is basically a way to save the world from annoying checkout form. This is basically a mediator in the browser native that proxy information between the merchant's website, the user, and the payment method. This is not an integrator with payment processor. It's not a new payment method. It's not a finalizer standard. And of course, it's not supported by Safari. But it's an open standard cross-browser supported by Chrome, Chrome Mobile, Edge, and very soon from Opera and Firefox, and allow you to do one-click payment through native UI. And despite its work in progress, out there it's already supported by more than 31% of the browser. How does it work? When the user clicks on the button, the callout button, you can call this API and open this widget. Basically, you can collect information from the user and eventually from a payment app like Android Pay and PayPal in the future, maybe. And then send this information to the browser and so to the website to complete the checkout process. So this is a playground on the mobile. You can see that you can open this widget. The user filling the information. And then after paying, you can see the first request go to the server. Can you see it? Yeah, filling in the CVV, first request. At this point, you do the payment, and when the promise is resolved, done. OK, now, this is a simple API. How can we implement it in a React component? We talked a bit about reusability before with Mars, great talk. But a lot of users understood when Flux architecture came out that you can move out your state, so your actions, your reducers. But a lot of users still were filling in the same files, UI and behavior, business logic. And that's the reason why a lot of people complain about JSX, right? The real point is that we have to find a way to encapsulate our business logic out of the UI component. And to do that, we should do a step back and remember what we learned at university. So what is a functor? It's basically a map. A function that maps objects and morphemes from one category and another category. There is one important law that needs to be satisfied. Basically, any commuting diagram in one category need to be mapped in another commuting diagram in another category. What it means is that simply, if you have a starting point and then one endpoint in one category, through composition and so reusability, you can end up with the same results in the other category. Simple, right? So to make it simple, really, this is the functor. This is basically a factory that accepts as input a Lambda function and returns as output another Lambda function. One friend in this room told me, well, to make it simple, to let people understand, put a pig instead of Lambda 1 and put a sausage instead of Lambda 2. That's formally wrong, because that's just a pure function that reduces your input. If you want a nice example, well, this is a functor. You are actually changing the interface and the behavior of your Lambda function. You are providing a completely different output with a completely different function. So this is a pseudocode that implements a high-order component. You can see that this is a factory that accepts a wrapper component as an input and then output a completely different component that swallows the configuration property and appends some new property to the new component. So basically, this is supported, show, and abort in this case. Okay. So the output is a completely different component. Why? because it's a powerful way to encapsulate behavior. It's a declarative API that can be the same for Angular and Polymer, and it's composable. At this point, check this repository out and have a look. Follow me on Twitter. Thank you.